Hearty welcome to all of you. Thank you very much for having made it possible to be here this morning. We appreciate your presence and wish you a nice time during the period of your stay here. Fruitful and meaningful duration that you spend here. May Baba be with you and he continues to shower his blessings on you and your families. Good to have his children also here. We just completed Baba's birthday. We certainly miss his physical presence, which cannot be compensated by any way, however much we may speak about it. We also miss his melodious voice, his physical presence, and his movement amidst us. They're all facts. But at the same time, if we just recall what he said earlier, we'll have some kind of reconciliation. What did he say? No one lasted forever. No prophet was ever immortal. No avatar is immortal. Those that have come down on earth in physical form are sure to leave the world. Because the organic principle is the birth, growth, and death. It's the nature of the body. And Rama is not there, Krishna is not there, Christ is not there, Prophet Muhammad is not there, Buddha is not here, Mahavir is not here. It only means anyone with a physical form cannot be immortal. But at the same time, the divinity within the physical body is eternal. The bulb may run off, but electricity is eternal. Like that, the body may naturally bound to fall, but yet the electricity of divinity is eternal and immortal. But there's one difference here. In the case of the prophets and avatars, when the body is withdrawn, they'll be with or in or around the five elements. When they want, they can come back anytime they want, anytime they decide to. But in our case, human beings, we are sure to be born again to face the consequences of our actions, to face the results of all our actions, what we call destiny or fate or karma. So we are bound by the law of karma, whereas God is bound by law of Leela, the divine sport. The divine sport, Leela, whereas this is karma. Well, these are all stated by Baba, not by Anil Kumar at this stage. So when once we recall the mind of those statements made earlier by Bhagavan, we get reconciled to the winds of change. In this context, I should also openly admit, without any reservation, that I met many, many, many who have established communication with Swami from within. There are many people, I met many. They are very simple, householders, housewives, very humble. They say, Anil, I talk to Swami every day. Oh, I see. And there are some that tell me, Mr. Anil Kumar, Swami advises me. And there are some that say that I listen to him through my inner voice. And there are some who say that I see him physically. I met quite a good number of people. Though I am not given to jealousy or envy till now, on grounds of material wealth and power influence, I feel jealous of these devotees who are of very, very high standard, who could establish communication with Swami from within. This is really marvelous. And many people. And I also feel humiliated when I observe many of them are foreigners. Many of them, 90% are foreigners who have established contact with the inner Swami. The rest of the 10% are Indians. I am sorry to say that, but it's a fact. Swami acknowledged it many times. Swami himself said, see those people, how happy they are. The moment they see me from a distance, they smile. When I just ask them, when did you come? They smile the whole day. When I grant them interview, the whole lot meet the gentleman, shake hands with him, feeling the vibration. How about you fellows nearby? Don't understand. Like frogs in a well, or like frogs closer to the lotus pond that does not know the taste of the honey there. Swami himself very much. So that's one side. And I also hear many people telling me, Swami cured of this disease. Swami solved this problem. Even now, all these things I said are mentioned in the books. All these things I stated are known to everybody. But now people themselves come open and tell us, after Swami left his physical body. In other words, my friends, Swami is more present now than before. I would draw the conclusion this way. He is showing his presence everywhere now. Was it not before? Yes. More patently now, more apparent, more glaring, more conspicuous, more frequent than earlier. And his works are going on. His projects are going on at different places all over the world. Bhajans are going on all over the world. Service activities are going on all over. They are all fully charged with devotion. Therefore, I do need to emphasize on his divinity. But yet I am surprised every time whenever I come across a true devotee telling me, Swami appeared. I saw him. I hear him. I feel him. Something to be envied. Not to be pitied. To be envied. I don't know when I would come to their standards of excellence. Even yesterday someone was asking me, do you see Baba in your dreams? How do you feel his absence? Having we used to see him both morning and evening, how are you taking the present position? I told them, gentlemen, I tell the truth. He, Swami is not appearing in my dreams, let me be very honest. Number two, since I am very busy in the outer noise, I am not able to hear inner voice. I cannot say that. I also cannot say that he talks to me, that I see him physically. I am not fortunate enough to have these experiences. But at the same time, when I speak about him, I feel him. Why? Because just as you listen to my talk, I listen to my own talk. If anyone says, you said that, I would also join and say, oh, did I say that? So I'm also a listener to my talk like you. I'm not mad, don't mistake me like that. Why did I say that? I said that because quite often, those are the statements I make are not planned earlier. Those are the thoughts that come to me are beyond my understanding and awareness. And certain of the terms, vocabulary, equivalents of philosophical dicta is beyond my capacity. So it appears as if there is some divine prompting, intuitive expression. That's how I feel him, why I told him yesterday. Therefore, my friends, we have varied experiences and we have to get into the next field. We have to get into the next field, next area in the world of spirituality. What is the next area? First of all, let us understand what's wrong with us. What's wrong with me? How to know what's wrong with me? How to know what's wrong with my temperature? There's a thermometer. How to know what's wrong with my blood pressure? There's apparatus. So just as there is equipment to know what's wrong with me, we can also detect, identify what is wrong with every one of us. We have our sumptuous breakfast. We are ready for a very good lunch. So nothing is wrong with us. No. All that is good is correct physically. All that is wrong relates to our mind. Ego, it is more than sugar. People say sugar, when once it comes, it won't go. So ego, when once it is there, it won't go so easily. Ego. Jealousy, envy, blood pressure. Miserly greediness is hypertension. So this is wrong with us. But here the patient does not know what's wrong with him. Outside, if one suffers from a patient or from temperature, he starts sweating and body is hot. With pride, he himself doesn't know that he is suffering from the disease of ego. The other fellows will tell him how egoistic he is, how envious he is, how greedy he is, how proud he is. The others are the doctors. He doesn't know what he is suffering from. Therefore, my friends, let us understand what's wrong with us. I understand these are the things that are happening in our life, in our day-to-day life. First thing, we are very, very conscious of our body, and we are very, very conscious of our stature, dignity, status, identity, I really pity people who think like that, I am important. Who said you are important? I should say you are important. You cannot declare yourself you are important, right? Do you? No. So, this kind of feeling important, separate identity, something great, is the first weakness we should get out of it as early as possible. How to do that? What is the remedy? The temperature is high. I can tell you, take paracetamol, it will come down. If blood pressure is high, well, take Atenolol, it will come down. If it is sugar, take Metformin, it will come down. So what should we do? What medicine you prescribe to come out of this identity crisis? And that and this. The medicine is service. Service is the medicine to get out of the disease of self-identity. From the complaint of ego, service. Why? Is it character drug? Yes. Because while serving, I don't feel VIP. Do you? So long you feel that you are a VIP, you cannot serve. Unless that VIP feeling is gone, you don't serve. Service is the only remedy, only curative drug for this deadly disease of identity. What kind of service? The service that we can do. Anything is service. Anything. Why? The station master, the train engine driver, the train guard, all those helpers on the platform, everyone contributes to the railways. Always, railways is the best example. If you say driver is not important, ask him to get down. We have to see all the names of the travelers in the newspaper next morning. If you say God is not important, yes. People who are going to the platform, they will be in chloroform, in the other world altogether. So, injury is necessary, compartments are necessary, God is necessary, station master is necessary, helpers are necessary for efficient working of railways. So station master thinks that I am the boss. Okay, let that driver be there. Can the station master run the train? No. So without anybody, the system won't work. Likewise, any work, any service, in service to God. So any service. How do you say any service? Which is selfless. What is the other quality? Done with love. Selfless service done with love is spiritual. But if I serve you expecting something from you, it is selfish. If I just do it mechanically, it is not service. So true service is the one done with love and selflessly. This will certainly make us free from body identification, so that you are free from that deadly disease of blood pressure of body identification in the spiritual parlance. What is the second disease with which we suffer from? Jealousy or envy. If anyone says that you are good looking, I don't feel like having a cup of coffee. If anyone says you are more intelligent, I feel like avoiding that person. These are jealousy. Why? Why do you think you are ultimate? I may be taller than you. There is another person who will be taller than me. There is another person who is taller than him. No one is ultimate in this world. Either the height, or weight, or complexion, money, or position, anything, no one is ultimate. There will always be another greater person. Therefore, to feel that, there is a beautiful medicine. To get away from the sugar of envy or jealousy, here is a medicine. What is it? Bhagavad Gita says, compare yourself with the vast sky. Sky, space. What are you? Nobody. Stand in front of the sea, vast sea, waves. What am I? What are you? Nobody. In front of stars, sun, moon, where are you? Nowhere. So to come out of this envy, jealousy, what could be done is to compare ourselves with the infinity. In front of infinity, I know my finity. In front of unlimited, I know my limitedness. This is what he said. Swami, in front of you, what am I? I'm telling you how I feel. How I take myself free from this deadly disease of jealousy and anything. Many people know me because I've been here for 24 years. And many people see me there, have seen me with Swami for 25 years, standing by his side. So they all say, Sai Ram, Sai Ram. Some say, Anil Kumar, we have seen you. You know what reply I give them? I tell them, when you go to Ganesha, you cannot avoid rat. That doesn't mean that rat is important. Rat cannot feel as important. It is important because it is the chariot of Ganesha. Therefore, you please don't compliment me. Because I am by his side, you saw me. Or else you will care for me. This is my real, genuine feeling. I am very honest with you. When all people come and say, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, I don't feel like that. I am really great. Swami, all things should go to you. Minus you, nobody will say, how are you? Because of you, everyone says, Sai Ram, Anil Kumar, you are that, 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 that. So when we look at God, we will understand we are nobody. And suddenly when you look at that infinity, how decimal, how minimal, how negligible we are. This is the way how to be free from the second problem. And the third problem, what we have is, only to judge people. She is good girl, she is bad man, she is very good, best on earth. No one like him is ever born on earth. We are used to their compliments. Some fish for compliments also. Flattery they want. What to do? They want praises. Ah, you are that, that, that. Good fellows. Politicians are very good ideal patients because they want always flattery. So these things are there, flattery, position, and that and this. Imagine you feel like that. This is all the outward or external worldly vision. External worldly comprehension, understanding, which is comparative, competitive, and relative. The worldly understanding is comparative, competitive, and relative. Ever changing. Only on one side of the coin. When once you turn within and get into the path of self-inquiry, close your eyes, everything is absolutely dark. Where are you? You do not know. Most of us don't want to have our eyes closed because we'll be nobody when once I close my eyes. Finish. When I open my eyes, I'm something. When you close, nothing. Therefore, the inward journey will make us free from all that external complaints, all problems. Something like multivitamin drug. Something like boost. Something like developing resistance against all problems. What is it? Self-inquiry. Self-inquiry is the only method to get out of all human weaknesses. It starts with silence. Self-inquiry, see, for some tests, blood tests or other tests, doctors want you to come in with empty stomach in the morning. Why empty stomach? That's necessary. Later, 2.5 hours after taking food, we'll test you, come again for the blood test. Similarly, self-inquiry, first close your eyes. Second, put a question to yourself, who am I? Because when once you close, you don't see your body, you don't see your mind. Nobody is looking at you. You are not looking at anybody. Anybody is nobody. What to do? Then you go on questioning, where are you? Where do you stand? You will ultimately land in that position of the Self, the Supreme. And that Self is the universal Self. That Self is the cosmic Self. That Self is the reality. Therefore, my friends, this birthday should take us along the lines of first examination. In the hospitals, tests, they do tests. So first examine, test ourselves, where we are in the spiritual path. Second, observation. Doctors will observe how it is fluctuating, how BP is fluctuating, how the temperature is fluctuating. So observe. Let me observe my behavior, my talk, my moments, my interrelationships, observation. Third comes prescription. Administrating the drug. Find out what is wrong with us. Is it envy or pride or jealousy or ego or miserliness? What's wrong with me? Greediness. And then you have correct prescription like service, like devotion, like self-inquiry. So that we lead a correct spiritual path. There's a correct spiritual path. Time is up. Time is fleeting. Age is advancing. Still. Some of us are so unlucky that we have our progress is not promising. Is not that forward as it should be. Having been with Swami 40 years, it is something like that. A man takes medicine for the last 2 months, no progress. Temperature continues, blood pressure continues, but he is taking medicine for 1 month. What do you say? Change your medicine or wait for your end. That's no other way. Change the medicine or wait for the end. So similarly, my friends, this kind of testing one's own things are followed by observation and prescription would take us to spiritual path and sadhana so as to realize the true self within us. And I'll be glad with these words of information and thoughts I have to share with you, inviting questions on this from your side. I'll be very happy, very happy, very thankful to you if you put questions, please. If you have any questions, please. No? How about you? Any questions, please? Yes, sir. Yes, sir, Gyan. You are the source of inspiration.
You know, I was reading in books, Swami's books and others, and one of the things they stated, and I'm going to ask you the question after I tell you what I understand. What they say is, although the self is here all the time, yet we seem to be oblivious to it because we don't seem to have acquaintance of the self. So my question is, how do you really develop the acquaintance with the self itself?
Acquaintance with the self is possible by realizing the existence of the self. Let us realize the existence of the self. What does Upanishads say about it? What is it that sees? I is not the one that sees. There is a seer who sees. Because blind people have eyes, but they can't see. So who hears? Not the ear. There is hearer who hears. Because there are many deaf people who cannot hear. So these five senses are only doors, are only windows. But there is a witness self. It is the self that makes the eye see. It is the self that makes the ear hear. It is the self that makes the skin feel the sense of touch. It is the self that makes the tongue to taste. Same self. Likewise, same electricity that makes the fan revolve, TV work, lights burn, same electricity. So the same principle of the self operates, making the body functional and effective. So to know the existence, we should realize the existence first, that there is existence. How do you realize existence? Comparing ourselves with those having eyes cannot see. Those having ears cannot hear. Then we will understand there is some power behind which is withdrawn. And that power is the power of the self. And that way we realize the self. When we concentrate more on the self, it is called meditation. When once we feel the self in everyone being the same, when once you feel that, experience that, it is called samadhi, the ultimate result of meditation. So meditation is to feel the self, to experience the self. And the result of the meditation is to know this self is same as the self anywhere all around. The cosmic self, the individual self is same as the universal self. That is the result of meditation, what we call samadhi. Am I clear, sir? Thank you, Sairam, Sairam. Thank you very much. Any question? Yes, sir.
Sir, how do you recognize the inner voice?
We can recognize the inner voice when it intuitively, because outer voice is heard, inner voice is not heard. So outer voice is different from inner voice. Understand me? Outer voice is heard. I am talking, you hear that. Inner voice, you do not hear. Suppose I say I am listening to my inner voice. Where is the guarantee? How am I to believe you? So inner voice is intuitive. Inner voice is the awakening of intuition. Simple example. Suddenly, you get a thought which is unexpected, about which no concentration has ever been made. Suddenly, a thought about Swami comes to you now. At a time you are not in concentration at all, at a time when your mind is revering, some thought comes all of a sudden relating to the inner self, that is inner voice. Anything that comes to your thought relating to the inner self is the inner voice. Simple example. Sometimes you feel relaxed. You feel, why don't you go for bhajans? You are relaxed, lying on bed. Suddenly, go to bhajan. That is inner voice. Time up, most of the bhajans are over. Only 2 or 3 bhajans will left. I can sleep for 10 more minutes. No, at least go for harati. There is inner voice. This is Sunday. Let me spend with my children pizza, burgers, vacation tonight. No, some service is going on go there. That is inner voice.
So inner voice never misguides, is it?
Never. Outer always misguides. Because outer voice goes by convenience. Inner voice goes by conviction. Outer voice is based on choice. Inner voice is choiceless. Outer voice is psychological, prompted by the mind. Inner voice is by intuition, which is intuitive. Outer voice is physical, secular, worldly. Inner voice is divine and totally spiritual. Am I clear, sir? Thank you. Very good question, very good question. Very good. I am so happy. This morning is really worth it because of questions from Yanni sir and you too. Really, very good. Because these questions are really, really valuable. Really valuable. Suppose I say I am coming in a raksha, I am coming in a riksha. There is another auto rickshaw is coming in front of me. It had hit me. Auto rickshaw is broken to pieces. Nothing had happened to me. This is Baba's miracle. So what? What is your message to me? What a transformation has come in your life? I can say one thing. If an experience, if a miracle has not brought any transformation in your life, if an experience or a miracle has not brought any change in your life, it is divine investment wasted. I keep 10,000 rupees in the bank. I don't get even 1 rupee as interest. Waste of money. So if there is no transformation, if there is no change, what for all these miracles? What for these experiences? So I personally feel that miracles, experiences are meant to change you, to transform you, to direct you towards spiritual life, to make you grow along the spiritual path. That's how I take it. Am I clear? Thank you. How do you know the difference between the mind and the inner voice? Mind is always external. Let me see this, let me hear that, let me go there, let me eat it, let me visit him, let me that. Mind is always public relations officer, PRO. Open to the public and to the whole world. But inner voice is not like that. Inner voice is the director. Inside. You find the hero, heroine on the screen, but you don't see the director on the screen. He's behind the screen. The inner voice is behind the screen. The screen of mind. The inner voice is behind the screen of mind, the director. When the hero acts as he likes, director will tell him, shut up, don't act like that. I'll tell you how to act. When the hero cannot do that, unless there is direction there. But there are some heroes out of arrogance, out of overconfidence, due to overaction, they don't pay heed to direction. So picture ends in a flop. Some of the films are total failure. Why? These actors out of arrogance don't follow the director. Similarly, mind does not follow the inner voice. Therefore we get into the trouble. When the inner voice, that is buddhi, our intellect tells us, we'll be all right. Am I clear? That's good. Thank you. You say, yes, please. Good question. At that age, to ask is quite good. For your age and experience, the topic being so serious and deep. In a general gathering, at a public meeting of devotees, we need to play to the galleries because we go by number of times that people clap. Oh yes, one man was telling, Anil Kumar, when I speak, there will be claps, applause, throat. I said, I don't think it is a good sign. He said, why not? How can they clap repeatedly? But then they want you to stop. Sometimes you find, because of poor speaker also, you find loud, thunderous applause. Why? Out of relief they clap. This fellow has ended at least now. In a small gathering like this, I don't expect anybody to clap. It is not necessary also. But in a general public meeting, we should care for public sentiment, public view, and see that it is like that. But in a small gathering, we can afford to be quite plain and free. But in public meeting, we have to play to the galleries, yes, to make yourself quite acceptable and popular. Here in small, face-to-face, heart-to-heart talk, we do need to play to the galleries. Yes. Am I Australia?
Relating to the previous question, sometimes in Swami's experience, how do you, when you interpret it, how do you know whether you're interpreting it correctly, or it's your mind interpreting it for you, and you're just, you get mixed up and confused?
Very good. I wish to meet you in Australia too. With these questions, yeah. While interpreting. How do you know it is out of the mind or some other else, right? My answer is simple. Everyone has one design, one pattern of life. What do you mean? Some like music, some like dance, some like poetry, some love movies, some like sports and games. Some are smokers. Some are alcoholics. Some are gluttons. Some are designed life, basing on vasanas. Basing on the previous life, the present life is designed. Because our inclination will tell what we are. Our inclination, tendencies, our traits, our vasanas. So the present pattern is based on our vasanas, our previous karma, our previous janma, our life. Simple example. I love pickles, spicy food. So my mind always says, why not? More hot stuff now. Why not that? But the intuition, our inner voice says, no, my boy, you cannot eat. Why? Your body cannot take spicy stuff anymore. Stop it. Mind is after pleasure and gain. Whereas inner voice is for your good, even if it is pain. Even if it is pain, inner voice tells you what is good. Mind always for comfort, for a gain. Gain. Then mind goes on changing its versions. Let me try this today. Let me try that tomorrow. Let me be like this today. Let me be in different style tomorrow. So it goes on changing. But that which is intuitive enough is not changing. Truth is truth. There cannot be yesterday's truth, today's truth, and tomorrow's truth. But mind says, interpret truth like this. Justify whatever you do is truth. That is mind. Am I clear? So that which is changing is the mind. That which is changeless is inner intuitive. Divine prompting or inner voice. Understood? What's your name? Oh, Swami, sorry. Any question, please, sir? I think my friends from South Africa are not disappointed with my talk. Because you may be expecting me to tell you some stories, some experiences. I certainly reserve them when I come to your place. Because a large gathering, these things are necessary. So I come with all spicy stuff at a public gathering. But in a small gathering like Gurukula, like ashram, where we have limited people and a kind of inner, deeper search after truth, no chance for humor, no chance for applause, no chance for claps or anything like that. Because it is cleaning process, cleansing process, spiritual sadhana. You don't find on records disciples clapping when Rama Maharshi speaks. History has not recorded Adi Shankara being cheered whenever he addresses his disciples. Because they always had a limited number of people had direct dialogue. But if they come to Hindu stadium, they have to change their procedure. See that everybody would be happy. Because it's a mixed group, you know. Those are beginners. Those who are yet to make a beginning of the beginning. Those are middle. So they have catered to the needs of many people in a mixed large gathering. But it's not so in a small gathering. We can be face to face, heart to heart, and go deeper and deeper into ourselves, which is the true spiritual path. Am I clear, sir? Thank you very much. I would appreciate if you are frank with me also.
Definitely we are frank. What we are here in the last hour is enlightened us a lot.
Enough to say that you are frank enough.
Yes, please.
Or shall I take it that there is no alternative other than to be? Yes, sir. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And I heard a lot about it. Many, many South African devotees coming. And I met many, many of them. They say Anil Kumar come to Johannesburg. Some say Anil Kumar Durban. I have come to know the places through many, many people. And large contingent come for Christmas. They take part in the decoration part of it. Very, very good number of people. It is unfortunate that I could not make it up till now. I would take it's my bad luck. Let us see that time would turn good, at least in the year 2013. Please convey to all of them, all your friends, that Anil Kumar is more anxious to be here. And he was disappointed that he could not be here before. And he loves to be here at the earliest. Please tell them. Thank you, sir. Yes? Okay, sir, shall we conclude? Oh, very good. Thank you, sir. Yeah, may Baba bless you. He wants to show us some interesting video now. Please. Piche Moon. Like Ryan Kira. I'm going to tell you.